sex, or you should pick someone of this ethnicity for whatever reason. I think that those things have been on the outs and are not really a great way to do governance. But on the question of whether people should, you know, attack inequalities that are a function of folks' race or class or ethnic background or nationality, I think that's obviously central, and I think something that she's focused on when she put out her policy proposals on housing last week. It was clear that part of her focus is on the homeownership gaps that exist.
The big argument against Kamala Harris was that she didn't have the necessary polling numbers. That does seem to be changing.
Head northeast on Helen Street toward Helen Saney XD.
Everyone would say, I mean,
in 600 feet, turn left onto Pennsylvania 103 North.
Very, very close election. She was improving on Biden's dismal standing at the time, and that's clear. She's able to consolidate a lot of low-hanging fruit.
Take the next left onto Pennsylvania 103 North.
But it's a very close election. It's unclear what's going to happen here. It remains to be seen whether they're able to win across the swing voters. The Trump campaign is working very hard to try to tag her as liberal out of touch, but poll numbers still show a very tight race.
Here's a final one. Do you think she can do it? Will she win?
I think it is very possible that she will win. She's clearly improving on Biden's poll numbers, and Trump is a uniquely vulnerable candidate. But it's going to be a close race, and it's going to really depend on what issues are salient come November. Is it going to be issues of immigration?
In a quarter mile, turn right onto U.S. 22, Business East, South Juniata Street.
And is, you know, is Trump going to sink himself if he shows up to this debate and the contrast between him and Harris is very negative?
Jerusalem Demsis, writer for The Atlantic. Well, with the spotlight firmly on Kamala Harris tonight, the BBC's Justin Webb has ventured outside the convention center to Chicago's south side. It's where Barack Obama once made a famous
convention. At the light, turn right onto U.S. 22, Business East, South Juniata Street.
Shot the hoop that went down in history, and they're still so proud of him here. And he did make a difference to places like this, particularly when it comes to the healthcare, much more available than was before he came to power. But, and it's a big but, there's an awful lot that hasn't changed and that people here say still has to.
All right, this is best class. All right, it's called Exercise Your Rights and Vote. All right, let's
talk about middle class, but nobody talks about poor.
In 1,000 feet, take the exit toward U.S. 322 West, U.S. 522 North.
Poor homelessness, then it's going to deplete the economy because we're going to constantly pour into that because they're going to stay in that situation.
Do you think Kamala Harris can speak for the poor?
I think that even if she wants to, she'd be afraid.
Take the exit toward U.S. 322 West.
She's got a policy, though, that says we're going to cap the prices, particularly at groceries. We're going to not let people price gouge, as she calls it.
In a quarter mile, turn right onto Kishakakia Street.
When I am elected president, I will make it a top priority to bring down costs and increase economic security for all Americans.
I'm going to make a big difference because right now, you know, they were saying because of inflation, grocery prices still are going up. And that's just a horrible thing.
Grocery prices are ridiculous now, so I love it.
Is that going to be the central thing? Because people talk about abortion rights, they talk about a whole set of issues in this direction. Does it come down eventually to
It comes down to dollar and cents, period. Abortion rights, I mean, of course, that's major, but it's not on the top of my list.
There is convincing to be done, but there are those in the party who think economic populism.
At the light, turn right onto Kishakakia Street, then turn left onto Green Avenue.
Delivers for poorer Americans in a way that previous Democratic administrations never have. Adam Green set up the Progressive Change Campaign Committee.
We need to unite Democrats, Republicans, Independents around the idea that we are the pro-worker party, pro-working families party, and we're willing to hold corporations who are bad actors.
Take the next left onto Green Avenue.
Standing next to a huge building site, people with hard hats all around it, and a great concrete tower in the middle of it. It is the Barack Obama presidential.
Continue for 11 miles.
It's got another year or two before it opens. There is investment in this area. There is interest in this area, in him, in the Democratic Party, and in the new candidate, Kamala Harris. The question they're all asking is the extent to which the interest in them carries on long after this library is built.
Chicago and wrapping up this Thursday night UK time edition of News Hour. Thank you for listening.
You're listening to the BBC World Service, and here's what's happening in the studio this week. But with the Argentinian artist Adam Inaliti, known for combining art and nature with their bold, colourful geometric work, they're creating an outdoor installation that's to be enjoyed by humans and also be a welcoming space for birds as well. In the studio at bbcworldservice.com/in the studio. The food chain is in 30 minutes. Cosmetic companies and celebrities claim collagen supplements can combat the signs of aging, and the number of capsules and gels and sachets appearing on the shelves is fast growing. How sure is the evidence they work? I'm with Holly Thunder, and I'm asking the scientists. This is the BBC World Service, the world's radio station.
Welcome to the Inquiry on the BBC World Service. The Vatican and the Chinese government have made a secret deal.
They basically have agreed that the Chinese church should be Chinese and Catholic.
For Catholics in China, the stakes could not be higher.
The fact that there is no confrontation anymore between these two entities, that is indeed the progress.
But it's a deal that has pitted many Catholics against the Pope.
Many have tried to make deals with the Chinese Communist Party, and no one has come out of it unscathed.
And the Pope has to decide soon if he should renew that secret agreement.
And the Vatican wants to be in relationship with all of us.
We're asking, is Pope Francis betraying China's Catholics? I'm William Crawley. Join me on the Inquiry after the news.
BBC News with Sue Montgomery. Kamala Harris will take to the stage in the coming hours to accept the Democratic Party nomination to be President of the United States. The Vice President's address will be the finale of the party's four-day convention in Chicago and the most closely watched speech of her life. Our correspondent, Emily Wells, is at the convention.
I think she'll want to be careful not to alienate Republican voters, even if she is going on the attack of Donald Trump himself. And that's partly because we know that this election is going to be won or lost in some really key swing states, where, and she will have a challenge on her hands to try and convince some people who would maybe traditionally vote Republican to perhaps consider voting for her this time around.
As negotiators gather in Cairo to resume talks on a ceasefire in Gaza, Israel's Prime Minister has dampened dwindling hopes of an agreement. Benjamin Netanyahu has denied reports his country is willing to compromise on one of the most divisive issues. Matt Thompson explains.
One of the biggest sticking points for the proposed ceasefire deal has been Israel's demand that its troops must remain in what's known as the Philadelphia Corridor, a thin stretch of land between Gaza and Egypt. Benjamin Netanyahu has insisted this is vital to stop Hamas smuggling in weapons. He's now scotched hopes that Israel might accept a compromise suggestion of stationing international troops there instead. Hamas, which will not be at the Cairo talks, has repeatedly insisted that it won't accept any deal that allows Israeli forces to stay in Gaza.
Canada's vast rail freight network has ground to a halt because of an industrial dispute, threatening significant disruption to businesses and consumers across the country and in the United States. Jenny Kumar reports.
Canada is the world's second biggest country by area and relies heavily on its railways to transport a wide range of products, including grain, vehicles and coal. This unprecedented stoppage will have an impact across North America, as around 75% of freight goes to the US. The dispute is over wages, rail safety and working conditions, but this is not a strike. The companies have said arbitration is needed and locked workers out so they cannot go to work.
Within the past few minutes, the Canadian Labour Minister has said he's imposing binding arbitration to end the dispute. Bangladesh's interim government says it's revoked the diplomatic passport of the ousted leader, Sheikh Hasina. The Interior Minister
Ministry said the decision also applied to former ministers of her government and to MPs no longer in post. The longtime Bangladeshi Prime Minister resigned earlier this month and fled to India after student-led protests. BBC News. A judge in Romania has ruled that the social media influencer and self-described misogynist Andrew Tate must be kept under house arrest while prosecutors investigate new allegations against him and his brother, Tristan. Sarah Rainsford reports.
Andrew Tate denounced the new investigation he's facing as a setup. He called it absolutely disgusting and claimed there was no evidence he's involved in human trafficking. Today, Romania's serious crime agency announced allegations that he and his brother were part of a criminal group, grooming women and forcing them to make explicit video content and then keeping the proceeds. One of the brothers, who's not named, is accused of having sex with a 15-year-old. The Tate brothers have already been charged in a separate case of human trafficking. They have always denied any wrongdoing.
The UN Children's Agency has strongly criticized the Somali authorities for executing four young people who were accused of being linked to the Al-Shabaab jihadist group. UNICEF said the four were put to death in the semi-autonomous state of Puntland at the weekend for offenses committed when they were under the age of 18. The authorities in Pakistan say 11 police officers have been killed in an ambush by heavily armed attackers in Punjab province. A police statement says two vehicles came under rocket fire when one of them broke down in the
of stuff this country's been doing, and Kamala Harris is representative of that. You don't have to vote for her per se to acknowledge the fact that the progress we've made is indicative on that stage.
And you know, David, how do you feel about that? Because obviously you're not going to vote for her, right?
But he's agreed with me. Too straight out.
Listen, it's a great country. We got a great country. The system's great. This is the great part about America. We get a chance. If the rest of the world were like us, we'd be great. We get to sit here and debate and have a civil debate about tough issues, right? I just saw my friend Harold Ford Jr. in the hallway. Another guy. You know, we don't necessarily see.
And it didn't come to blows.
No, we weren't fighting. McCarthy and I disagree about a ton of things. And we don't get along on things. Doesn't matter. We still love our country. We still want to see the best things for it. We just don't agree about how we're going to get there, but we want the best things for the people.
Well, it's nice to have a moment like that. Now, you've been in the middle of this as we're ready for this last night. You're seeing people come in. We saw the sound check. Pink going to be one of the big performers tonight, maybe a surprise in addition. But you've been through, as we're getting ready for Harris's speech, giving a speech here. You say it was one of the, how shall we say?
Well, it's the highest hurdles of your career.
How would I put it positively?
It's difficult because you know, there's so many logistics to deal with. There's the time constraints. There's the vetting. There's the wanting to say what you want, but maybe it's not the right message. But can I tell you, I don't think anybody tells Bill Clinton what to say. I don't think anybody tells Oprah what to say. And I don't think anybody's telling Kamala Harris what to say or how long she has to say. So I think she's going through a very different process. I do want to tell you regarding what Bakari was just talking about in the historical moment. Last night, don't ask me how, I wound up sitting behind Chelsea and Hillary Clinton as they were listening to Bill Clinton give his speech. And after that, I was talking to Hillary Clinton, and I talked to her about how in 2016, we let the historical moment slip through our fingers like sand. And she told me the story of how many people came up to her in 2016 after the election and said to her, I'm so sorry. I didn't go and vote because I thought you had this won. I took it for granted. I thought you had it in the bag. I'm so sorry. And lived with remorse for 4 years. I think Democrats have learned their lesson and are not going to take anything for granted and not make that mistake again.
David, having been in the room every day here, how does it feel tonight? This is the final night, right? This is the big event. This is her, you know, coming out to the country as the nominee. And there is an enthusiasm and a fullness in this room even before it begins.
Oh, without a doubt. But, of course, her mission goes far beyond this room. And that's what the speech needs to be focused on, about how she's making the case to everyone in their living rooms, not just in this room, who are going to participate in this election. And so she has a lot of different notes to hit, but on the history piece of this, on what you're describing here, I do think this is one of the most fascinating things about her short candidacy so far. I mean, I can't believe we're not 5 weeks into this candidacy yet, and yet here we are on this night. She is not leaning in and daily as part of her speech to an identity politics. She's not pointing to the history every single speech that she's out there. She doesn't have to. She's the physical embodiment of it. And I think it's actually, it's going
in
to be
a quarter mile, slight right on the U.S. 522 North.
Issue of future versus past. Joe Biden, as the candidate, Aaron, could never be able to successfully message the message that we've heard all week long here about turning the page and moving forward, just because of who he is as an 81-year-old man. She, just by being the first woman,
slight right on the U.S. 522 North,
to do this tonight, that is in itself already a message about turning a page.
Right, and it's not even necessarily about age, right? I mean, she's 60 years old. She's young relative to 81, but it's not about age, right? It's about the vibe, right?
She fell the vice president of that, but she's...
Continue on U.S. 522 North for 20 miles.
Tonight, she's got to do something else. I mean, she has a portion in which she pays a huge tribute to Donald Trump.
Yes.
Excuse me, to Joe Biden. To Joe Biden. But also, one of the things that everyone will tell you who's around her, who knows her thought process about this speech, is that tonight is about one word, and that's strength. And she wants to come out and exude strength. We've done the joyful, we've done the happy part. Now is the time for the warrior part. And you're going to see that. It's going to still have the same vibe and tenor, but tonight's speech is about strength.
head of the Space Council, which is a new national security domain, and she's led on the issue of artificial intelligence, which I can tell you is the new frontier when it comes to national security, among so many other things. Other than President Obama, you probably have your eyes on all of these tectonic figures in Democratic politics. President and former First Lady Michelle Obama, President Joe Biden, and Kamala Harris. Just tell me how you've seen those plates shift just over the last 5 weeks.
Well, it's been an extraordinary last 4.5 to 5 weeks, obviously. I was so proud to serve President Joe Biden and Kamala Harris in their White House. President Biden's record and the Biden-Harris record in terms of domestic accomplishments, which is what I was privileged to work on, have been extraordinary, from reducing the price of and the cost of health care, $35 insulin for seniors. There's so many things that we have been able to get done. The first bipartisan gun safety legislation in 30 years, tremendous support through the PACT Act for our veterans. It has been extraordinary to be part of that. And yet, after all of his accomplishments, and I think President Biden will rightfully be remembered as one of the greatest presidents and one of the most accomplished presidents, certainly since Lyndon Johnson. He made the incredibly courageous, selfless, and patriotic decision to pass the
hot sheet jeffers from Donald Trump. We'll hear a lot about Project 2025 and how she thinks that she can take the country forward, not turn it back. And then finally, we're told that there's going to be a lot of talk about patriotism. And I think this gets to the point about, reaching out to the independents and the swing voters to talk about love of country, to say, you know, there's a time when Republicans kind of own the flag of American politics. And you saw it with Bill Clinton, and you saw with Barack Obama, where Democrats were able to take the flag back and say, we're just as patriotic, and we love this country just as much as you. And that third part, to make the point that she understands Middle America. She is not just a coastal candidate of the East Coast and the West Coast. Enormously important for her.
All right, guys, don't go too far away. We have a lot more to discuss. Coming up. Up next, we're watching what's going on here at this convention, and we're going to take you back to the convention floor. Our own Caitlin Collins is standing by with actress and co-founder of Voto Latino, Rosario Dawson, is standing by. Plus, Kamala Harris's close friend and Democratic Senator Afonso Butler joins us with new insight on what the Vice President's message will be tonight.
first, just on what we're going to see on that stage tonight, Vice President Harris, her turn to make the argument for herself. What do you want to hear from her?
You know, I think we had a standing up ovation for Joe Biden that lasted 4 minutes, in appreciation for him stepping down from the ticket and for things like the infrastructure bill and the Inflation Act that is going to be massively beneficial, especially around the environment for communities across this country. And now we get with, you know, Kamala Harris and Tim Walz, you know, presidency, the opportunity, especially with older Latino, the communities that we reach out to, an immigrant story, a working class story, you know, people who really, truly believe on the issues around affordable housing, LGBTQI issues, women's right to choose, like someone who fortifies in this space whenever you look across her track record, as well as his, policy that can actually be put in, even with a slim majority. I think people are very, very excited about the possibilities and what we could be voting for versus what we're voting against in this particular election. And, you know, I call this the, you know, unbridled joyvention in stark contrast to the Republican convention. And so I think, you know, this enthusiasm needs to be capitalized on at the polls. And we're going to hear a very strong message that I think is going to galvanize people to do exactly that.
And of course, we heard from your co-founder on stage. And the group, 20 years it's been since you founded it, which is pretty remarkable.
Yeah.
Donald Trump has been making a lot of inroads with Hispanic voters since, not just his last election, but since 2016, certainly. What does your party, what do Democrats need to do to counter that, to bring those voters back in before November? Because there's obviously, as you know, not a lot of time.
No, not at all. Honestly, you know, when I started Voto Latino, you know, one of the big things that was trying to get people to speak to Latinos in English and not just on Spanish radio and Spanish television, if you were really serious about getting their vote. As of 2010, they are the second largest demographic of Americans in this country. They have an unprecedented voting power that is unparalleled. And, you know, in previous years, it's only been growing. And we've been seeing the numbers coming in when the Republican Party is saying they're going to repeal their Affordable Care Act. They're going to do mass deportations. They're going to, you know, rescind Social Security. They understand how devastating that can be for their communities. And so we're seeing, you know, as Maria Teresa said yesterday, which had me in tears,
determined, thoughtful, loving, compassionate, prepared. Which is that's a great list of attributes to have for someone. You know, the other context here in these next hours is just what this room's going to be. And I know, you and I both heard Pink prepare to her sound check. There are going to be other performances tonight. And you've got this sea of a lot of people wearing white in honor of suffrage. What does it mean to you to be in this room? You've been here all week, but this night will be a little bit different. It will be different.
Yeah.
What does it feel like to you?
It feels like I grew up in Mississippi. I went to a historically black college. On my campus was the Fannie Lou Hamer Pre-Law Society. I have thought about very much the story of Shirley Chisholm in this moment. And I think tonight we're going to get to witness and experience the full ambitions and dreams of those women, but most importantly, the aspirations of America's daughters to be able to imagine, truly see.
In a quarter mile, turn left on Pennsylvania 104 North, North Main Street.
All right, well, you'll be here for it. And Senator Miller, thank you so much. It's good to see you and in person.
Thank you.
All right, and just ahead, we're going to speak to a close advisor to Kamala Harris, who has been with the vice president and has new details about her thinking and preparations for tonight.
At the light, turn left onto Pennsylvania 104 North, North Main Street.
Thank you.
see from President Trump, who, when he was in the White House, all he did was foster chaos and division around the world, kiss up to dictators, abandon our allies. These are things that we can't afford to go back to. And so when it comes to tonight, when she'll speak to the country, she'll talk about the kind of global leadership that she would bring to the White House, including on the war in the Middle East.
So why was a Palestinian American denied a speaking slot tonight?
Well, I think that we've given them a lot of opportunities to engage in this process at the convention. People have had dedicated panels, for example, during the daytime programming here at the convention to talk about these issues. We're, of course, continuing to engage with the group and make sure that, that the Vice President's position on this issue is heard and that their voices are heard and reflected in our convention.
Ian Sash, thanks very much for joining us. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
And coming up, we'll talk to one of the biggest political TikTok influencers out there. His videos are getting millions of views. Are young people for Harris's secret weapon step up?
Last thing you would want is for your family to have to sell the house. That's... We can get you covered in just 10 minutes.
Continue for 5 miles. 45 East Old Turnpike Road. Take the next right onto Pennsylvania 45 East Old Turnpike Road.